I'm switching to a new format here, folks. I'm having so much trouble rendering videos, uploading videos, and the most terrible problem is once they're uploaded, YouTube is saying failing to process, cannot process it. It's the exact same format I've used before many, many times, so there's no rhyme or reason why it would do this. But taking into account that my eyes are going bad from too much staring at a fixed focus on the computer screen, and I'm so busy in just taking care of life, that this is probably a much faster way. I'm recording direct to YouTube. So let us try that, and maybe it will save me a lot of time and effort and trouble and days of frustration with not having the uploads, you know, go through. And in asking about whether people cared about the background video or the message, what was more important, the answer was that I received was that it's the message that's more important. We should not worry so much about the eye candy backgrounds. So with that in mind, maybe we can take another step forward, another huge step forward in delivering this satsang here to the world. Easier for me, and maybe more of it, with the message being clearer and no delays, as I've been experiencing so many delays. Anyone who works with computers and tries to do something like this realizes that it is really very, very frustrating and difficult. Requires enormous patience, and things that used to work perfectly, suddenly they stop working perfectly. So here we are. It's a wonderful opportunity to share the truth. I'm asked questions about what do you think about this, or what about this, or what about that. Here's my answer to those questions. Our job is to seek out that situation where we don't feel like we need to ask any questions. That the host of the satsang, we must find a satsang where we feel that host, we don't feel any need to ask any questions. Don't need to interrogate the host or put the host on the defensive, because if the host of the satsang is put on the defensive, there is no satsang taking place at all. Everyone's time is being wasted. One has to have faith that the host will touch upon what is most crucial. It's that simple. And that there should be no notion of argument or discussion, confrontation, anything like that, where there's no pressure on anybody, no pressure on anyone. Then that means that one's attention is fully present and becomes very sharp and very clear, and they're simply paying attention and getting everything they can out of it, and just having faith that the host will be touching upon the essential areas and emphasizing what is truly essential and letting go all the other stuff. So my answer to questions is to say, find a situation where you feel like you don't need to ask questions. That's better. That's better than me trying to answer any questions. The entire situation upside down and backwards. A satsang is a situation where there is a host and there are those who attend, and the host provides the emphasis and those who attend have their attention on point, very clear, very present, and they maintain that as much as possible and allow intuitive seeing to take place. And there again, answering any questions is a verbal thing, and questions must be answered with intuitive seeing. Otherwise, every wordy answer to a question only gives rise to more questions, more confusion, more difficulty. And intuitive seeing is like a holistic type of seeing, panoramic seeing. It sees the situation in context, in the right context. Really, seeing the right context answers vast multitude of questions because they don't even arise at that point. Oftentimes questions are merely someone complaining, saying, I can't see the context, I can't see the context. Okay, so what's important is to see the context, but that seeing has to be intuitive. Cannot be done through arranging words. So a satsang is when there is a host and there are attendees to the satsang, and the host presents various suggestions for emphasis, and those there simply allow clarity to arise within their attention. And when you are really focused in, clarity will click in at some point. It's not consistent. It's not like at the 3-minute mark clarity kicks in. One never knows. Sometimes it comes at the end. Often in these videos, the greatest clarity comes towards the end. Seems like there's momentum that's built up, and then we go forward, our courage grows, our conviction and clarity grows, and then we manage to get into a really, really profound situation. Right now, this video is simply focused at the sunset here where I am speaking. I am speaking looking at exactly what you are looking at, which is a lot better than looking at me at this time. I'm tired after a long day of work, and this is much more interesting. It gives a more neutral type of setting, so one doesn't feel that there's some kind of requirement for interaction. There's no need for any personal interaction. The highest type of relationship is attending satsang. That is the true highest relationship. Everything else needs to be civil, of course, polite, kind, civil, compassionate. But that's it. Nothing more than that. Attending satsang is being in relationship with truth. And that's the real relationship that we are aiming towards. What we're aiming towards, of course, is to choose to abide in the experience of the overlay. The vision of Christ, the vision of oneness, samadhi, nirvana. Abide in that feeling. And there's nothing more that reminds us of what we are. That is the reminder of what we are, of what we truly are, of what we are in truth. Not something that we've imagined ourselves to be, which is something we've imagined that what we are is modifiable, is capable of being modified. That's not true. In order to believe this, we've created a vast cosmos of modification. And so we believe, wow, what we are must be modifiable. It's not. Never has been, never will be. And we wonder, how in the world can we possibly remember this perfectly, because our remembrance also can't be modifiable, right? If our remembrance is modifiable, how can we truly remember what we are? Because our remembrance will be modified. So we need a remembrance that is not modifiable, and that is what I call the overlay. The overlay. Soft, gentle, seamless presence. That's what it is. And it doesn't change, it's not modified, it's not modifiable. And in experiencing this, we remember our true nature as spirit, that we're not modifiable, that the God, the Prime Creator, is not modifiable, and that what is created is not modifiable. And only this remembrance is attainment, nothing else. But these are the basics. And so this is a wonderful test that we are taking part in. It's really very, very exciting. I've been putting this off. Every day I struggle to try and figure out, how can I deliver the best content for you, share it with you. And I've just tried so many, many, many different ways. And I hope this way is just the simplest and the most direct and the most effective. And right now I'm seeing that the visuals are kind of taking care of themselves as the sun sets and hits that bird of paradise there. It's just, I didn't plan this, it's just happening. And it's nice. So I'll just let it keep rolling like this. There's always problems when you get with a computer. Everything you think should work, and then there's a bug, there's something that doesn't go the way that you would expect it to go. C'est la vie. And however, we can still persevere and prevail here over all these problems, as we are doing right now, and that's exciting to be able to do that. In spite of all the obstacles, here we are, listening to clarification, highest kind of clarification, getting right to the root of our situation. And that's actually very profound. Very, very profound, and yet very, very simple. And I certainly hope that this video will process. I don't see why it wouldn't, being that it's being directly recorded to YouTube. So, the sun is setting, meaning the day is being modified ceaselessly. As you see this, the sun is slowly sinking in the horizon, and you get different effects. Everything is being modified. The angle of the light is different. The warmth, the heat of the light is different. The tone of the light is different. Position in the sky of the sun is different, and as it moves, reflections are different, shadows are different. Everything is ceaselessly being modified. Even the shadows, of course, are all constantly being modified as the sun moves about. But what we are cannot be modified at all. It can be extended, but extension doesn't modify what is doing the extending. Just like God, the Prime Creator, was not modified by extending itself as Spirit. God, the Prime Creator, remains the same, unmodified. It is now simply expanded. But what is, always is. Everything in creation always is exactly what it is. And yet there's just more and more and more of this isness, greater and greater and greater expansion, endless experiences and adventures to go on. All of that eternal and endless. And in this world here, there's nothing eternal, nothing endless. Just everything turns into dust and is undergoing all this modification. So this keeps us in a state of forgetfulness. Deep, 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 deep forgetfulness. We have to emphasize this, and we must emphasize that this world arose as a whim on the part of Spirit. Spirit wanted to try and be Prime Creator. That was a whim. It wasn't based on anything else, because Spirit knows it's impossible. But it's Spirit suspended this knowledge and awareness on a whim. Say, well, what the heck, you know, let's do it, let's try it anyway. What could go wrong, you know, let's find out. It's just a kind of a bold adventurousness that says, let's find out. Well, we found out. And once we found out, then we say, okay, we found out now, we know what it is, and that's enough of that. You know, let's try something else, let's try not to be Prime Creator. Spirit wanted to be Prime Creator, just to try it out. See if it's possible. Now it knows it's not possible. It should know that. So, the fact is that this universe did not arise out of necessity. Rather, out of a whim. So none of this is out of necessity. We don't need to continue on with it. We don't need to do anything with it. We don't need to maintain it. And if we say it was out of necessity, we'll also believe that it's because the reality was destroyed, and therefore we must seek elsewhere. We must forget it. The memory being too horrible to ever look at. We must look elsewhere. But that's, again, that's a false premise that we have told ourselves. That reality was destroyed, and therefore we, out of necessity, existence must arise, this scenario of forgetfulness. And then as we're forgetting, we're working on creating a new creation, that we're prime creator. Very convenient belief, completely based on a completely false premise, because existence has not been touched or modified at all by our dreams of modification. Has not. These are the essentials. These are the essentials of satsang that bear repeating like a broken record. And I have made many videos doing this. Some of them have failed to upload, so I'm repeating, going over some things that I've already spoken about. And if this works, if this format works, we will have, at least for a while, for now, a stable format that we're able to utilize, that minimizes my time and still delivers the essential message for you. So it's a win-win if we can get this to work, and I sure hope that it will work. I don't see any reason why it won't, but you never know. Stability in this world is not possible. It's never possible. There's no stability in existence. Spirit is stable. What we are is stable. Instability brings about deep forgetfulness of what we are. We cannot remember what we are when we're experiencing and focused on instability. That's why it's so crucial for us to choose a new idea and experience the effect of that idea. The idea of not trying to be prime creator brings with it an experience of stability, because that effect is not changing. It's not getting more, it's not getting less, it's not diminishing, it's not morphing into something else, it's not mixing with something else, it's not fragmenting, it's not blending with anything, you know, it's not incorporating, it's not teaming up with any other effect. Just that one effect of overlaying all other effects remains entirely stable. That is our goal. That has always been pointed out as the goal. Different terms are used to refer to it, but it's always our goal. Very still here now, as you can see. There's a little bit of breeze tickling things. Evening, dove is cooing. The crows are always commenting. Bugs are zipping all over the place, enjoying a warm spring evening, dusk. And here we are, with no need to go anywhere, no need to say anything, no need to ask any questions. Because we realize that we will receive more answers simply by listening carefully without feeling a need to generate a question out of anything that we hear or see. And I am going to try and find a way to upload a video that I just previously worked on yesterday. It's 2.5 hours and it contains an enormous amount of information, but I cannot seem to get it to process. YouTube just won't process it. But I'm going to keep trying on that, because it was really, really the best one yet. And it goes into the great importance for you to feel no pressure to ask questions. As soon as you feel like you need to ask questions and you're listening to figure out what question is best to ask, that knocks you off your axis of attention. You shouldn't feel any such pressure. And you shouldn't take any notes. Notes are simple. Again, words. Words can never capture the clarity of intuitive seeing. And one is then thinking, well, what kind of words can I use to for this? And then, again, one is not fully present. Being fully present for intuitive seeing, panoramic seeing, clarifications will come. And they will go. They go because, of course, we think that we need to meet up with them, that they're going to be modified, and so we steal a march on it. We be proactive. We say, okay, I'm experiencing this right now. I'm very clear about it, but I know it's going to modify, and therefore the smart move is to figure out what it might modify to. Start thinking about that so that you can catch up with it in its modified condition later on. That seems to be the smart play. But we know through experience that backfires on us very badly. Because we don't meet up with it again, and we're thinking, where'd it go? What happened? Yeah, we don't meet up with it again. Because it doesn't modify. Truth does not modify, ever. And that's a fact. So we can expect interruptions here from time to time, being that we're outside, and activity is taking place all around us. There's the roar in the distance of traffic. Neighbors are bustling about. All sorts of creatures are still active from the day. And yet, we know for sure that truth is simple enough that we can get to it right away and return to it right away. It's not being modified. You see, that's the very important message. Truth is never being modified. What can modify truth? Can lies modify truth? No. The number one lie is the lie of saying that truth can be modified. That's the origin of all lies, isn't it? That's the root of all lies, the belief that truth can be modified. As soon as we accept that lie in any way, we're truly lost. And every glimpse we get of truth, we will jump back from it and go to work feverishly on trying to catch up with it on down the road in some modified form. We say, okay, we saw it there, but we know it won't remain that way. So let's be real clever and see if we can decipher how it might change. And so then we look at the world of modification and change in nature and think that we can figure something out from it. So we contemplate nature, believing that this will give us insight into how truth might be modified. All, of course, entirely unnecessary and ludicrous, because truth is never modified. As you can see here in this video, modifications are taking place all the time. The sun is dropping. All the dappled light is changing. The overall amount of light is decreasing as we head towards that inevitable phase that we call nighttime. I used to absolutely detest nighttime. Any darkness, I couldn't stand it. I still don't like it. I always feel like this world acts in a completely bizarre way. And why does light, why do we have night at all? You know, that's the question. Why does this happen like this? Well, it's everything is set up here to highlight modification. Nothing stays stable. Nothing stays the same. The entire cosmos is constantly moving. Everything is moving in relationship to everything else. We're not even aware of the extent of that, but this planet and solar system is whirling through space very fast, and its position in relation to everything else in the cosmos is literally constantly changing moment by moment by moment, never the same. That's a fact. It's kind of a frightening fact, because we look out at this scene here and we kind of just suppose that it's very stable and nothing's really changing. But in the big picture, our position in relationship here on the planet, where we're sitting right here, my position, for instance, in relationship to every last other thing in the whole cosmos, is changing every moment. Every single moment. It's pretty amazing, isn't it? That all the stars in the sky, our position is to them is changing every single moment. Slightly. Subtly, slightly. But it's different. We're never in the same place, moment by moment by moment. If we look at that bird of paradise there, you can say, well, I'm in the exact same relationship to that bird of paradise every moment. Well, even that is not entirely true, because it's moving subtly. But on a larger scale, this planet is in a different relationship to everything in the cosmos, ceaselessly, every single moment. And every moment is never the same, as far as that goes. And that's a very panoramic way of looking at it. Seems to, that insight hits hard. Nothing's ever the same. And you could say that about the entire cosmos. Everything in the cosmos is in a different relationship to everything else in the cosmos, moment by moment, every single moment. And you say, well, that bird of paradise hasn't moved and we're in the same relationship with it. But contextually wise, my experiencing of that bird of paradise includes the entire cosmos, and I'm in a different relationship with the entire cosmos each moment. And just look at that sun. We're in a different angle, different spatial relationship with that sun every single moment. And so, there's nothing stable here. Everything is in a different relationship with everything else, ceaselessly. Quite a realization. Now, what happens when you have sort of a profound insight like this? I've never had that insight before. First thing to do is don't worry about writing it down. Don't worry about putting it into writing a book about it. Realize that this is a truth, and the same truth will always be there, exactly the same as it's always been, because truth is not in a different relationship with something ever. It's always the same. Nothing can change or modify it. So this insight will always be present. It's always been true. Just because we see it now doesn't mean it wasn't true before. It's always been true. We've always been in a different relationship with everything else in the cosmos, every single moment. But now we're seeing it, we're emphasizing it, we're highlighting it, we're focusing our attention on it. And this can be done at any time. So what one does when one sees this, and there's a feeling like, kind of like a wow feeling. Like, this is different. I haven't seen this before. This is a game changer. Because the instability, the totality of the instability is seen. And you know, it's easy to realize here now that can't quite go back the way things were before. Somehow the equation has shifted. Now, do we need to itemize all the? Do we need to measure it? The shift? No, it's taken place. It's already taken place. Just let it be. Don't think about it. Don't try to measure it in any way. Don't try to capture it in a snapshot. Just check in and see how you feel. I'm checking in. I feel fine. Feel sort of like a wow moment, you know, a wow. So there's a little feeling, different, little sort of kind of mild, positive agitation or something like that. No reason to do anything about it. Just remain calm, remain quiet. Let it sink in. And the great thing about satsang is there's always other clarifications that come up. So we don't need to say, oh, that's it. You know, we had the great clarification. Well, we had one great clarification there. Absolutely. That's what it's all about. But we can get into more and more and more. How much is this video gone? Let me check it here for you. 31 minutes. Okay, we've been going 31 minutes. Now, carrying on with this insight and how it feels, there's always a feeling of like wanting to get up and run somewhere, go somewhere. You know, you have to not allow that to happen. Remain still, not locked or frozen, but just don't let the feeling of like, well, I need to get moving somehow. Don't let that take over. Because it's like we just realize that the universe is totally unstable. And we feel like we need to move somewhere that's stable, to get somewhere that's stable. But if the entire universe is unstable, where can we go? You see, that's what's profound. We say, well, wait a minute. This is a game changer. I mean, there isn't anywhere I can go. Look at it this way. Let's say we're feeling, we get this insight, and we say, uh-oh, let's go where it's stable. And so we jump on a jet and fly over to Tiruvannamalai, you know, southern India, and we go to Arunachala, maybe Ramana Ashram there, and we say, okay, whew, I finally made it in here, and I finally found a place that's really stable, you know, stable. And as you're sitting there, you'll ask yourself, now wait a minute, isn't my position as I'm sitting here in relationship to all the stars in the sky, isn't it also changing every single moment? Just spatially, my angle spatially. I mean, the world is still turning very rapidly, and it's also turning on its axis, which changes my position relative to those stars constantly, right? It's going in a orbit around the sun, so it's going latitudinally, sort of going, the motion is going very rapidly around the sun, so it's changing its position in space that way constantly. So both spinning and going orbiting the sun, two changes there, and also the solar system itself is moving. So that's a third type of motion that is constantly in place, and the whole galaxy too is moving. So you have all these different movements that are ceaselessly taking place, and so our position, moment by moment, is greatly changed in relationship to every other position in the cosmos. And everything in the cosmos, of course, also is also moving ceaselessly. And we can't stop any of this. Going to Ramana Ashram is not going to stop any of this at all. And so we get that this realization, like, well, wait a minute, you know, well, what can I do? Where can I go? If I want to experience stability, how is that possible? And so then we, this feeling we have of like slight agitation, slight panic, thinking like, well, wait a minute, you know, I didn't realize that I'm constantly changing my position relative to everything. How many billions of planets are there out there, and suns, galaxies, solar systems? I mean, it's just almost infinite. And yet our position to all of that is ceaselessly changing. As is the position of a grain of sand, as is in the same position, a grain of sand on a beach, its position in relationship to the entire cosmos is ceaselessly changing. Every last thing that you see, that bird of paradise there, its position relative to everything in the cosmos is ceaselessly changing. We're all in the same boat that way. All everything, every last piece of dust in this is all in the same boat. Every last bit of the cosmos is all in the exact same boat. There's nothing in the entire cosmos that maintains its position. This is a very deep type of insight, very, very wide, extremely wide and panoramic insight. And it's great to be able to share this with you right here on the video. And I'm just sitting here, you know, pondering it basically, sort of looking into it a little deeper, saying, oh, wow, this is pretty amazing. I mean, you mean that all the pine needles on that pine tree are also ceaselessly changing their position vis-a-vis the entire cosmos? And that is a fact. Yes, they are. Oh. You might say it's a pretty cosmic insight. So, in one way, you might say that these plants are not as stable as we think they are. Because they literally are changing their position in relation to everything in the cosmos every single moment. So, what is it that's not moving in the cosmos? Anything? We could be glib and say space. But even everything that is moving through space is changing their position in space constantly. So you'd have to say space in sort of an abstract way. But really, from a practical standpoint, there's nothing that maintains its position in the entire cosmos. Because space is only termed space because there's something in space. If there was nothing at all there, why would we even refer to it as space? So, since it's like space and the things in space are two sides of one coin, and since everything is changing its relationship within space constantly, we have to say that space is also part of that equation of constant change. The spatial relationships are in the cosmos are ceaselessly changing. So in the cosmos, there's nothing that is stable, nothing that is not changing its position. There's nothing that is not having its position modified, nothing. And what we are as spirit is not modifiable. It's never changing its position. Its relationship to everything is exactly the same as it's always been. entirely different. So this entire cosmos is a deep, 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 deep forgetting of what we are. And there's nothing in the cosmos that can remind us of that, because whatever we're looking at this bird of paradise here. But the fact is that this bird of paradise is changing, shifting its position in relationship to every last bit of the entire cosmos, every single moment. So how stable is that? It's not. What is stable is the effect of another idea. The idea of not trying to be prime creator means the idea of not trying to change reality, which means the idea of not trying to forget what we are, which means that nothing has to be modified, which means nothing needs to be changed. The effect of that idea is stable. I call it the overlay. It overlays all change, but it itself does not change. Nirvana means not moving, not changing. The great gurus say you must enter into nirvana, the experiencing of the unchanging. And you must do that to remember what you are, have a deep, clear remembrance of what you are, what we really are, spirit. Nirvana, without movement, without change. That's the vision of oneness. Seamless peace beyond understanding. Gentle overlay. This effect is not changing. Everything moves within it, moves, is continuously moving. But it is not generating anything other than just this one effect, one overlay. So it's really beyond space. It overlays space. It overlays space because space and the objects in space are actually one. So it overlays space and everything that moves in space, all spatial relationships. Space infers spatial relationships. Otherwise, it's a meaningless term. So the overlay overlays all spatial relationships. And all these spatial relationships are ceaselessly changing. The overlay is not changing at all. It's not moving. Because everything is overlaid simultaneously. All spatial relationships are equally overlaid. The overlay doesn't have to increase, decrease, shift, change, move. There's nowhere for it to move. People ask Ananda Mayama where she was going. She says, how can I go anywhere? I'm everywhere. I can't even turn around. I can't move. There's no place to move because I'm everywhere. This is the voice of the overlay. This is speaking from the standpoint of the overlay. There's nowhere to go. She says, I'm ceaselessly simply within myself, not going anywhere. She says, how can I go anywhere? I'm everywhere. That's the standpoint. That's the perspective it comes from, experiencing the overlay. And that is the goal of satsang, always has been, always will be. Whatever time and place we find ourselves, no matter where in the future, let's say a billion years in the future, wherever we are, we will still, in this cosmos, we will still be moving about and changing our relationship, spatial relationship with everything else, ceaselessly. Exact same situation. Everything will be modified. There's all sorts of modifications taking place, from the cosmic down to the planetary. Just think about it, in the body, there's just a vast, vast array of ceaseless activities taking place in the body. The blood is flowing. That's a constant change right there. Every molecule in our body is changing its relationship. Every, let's say, blood cell in our body is changing its relationship to every other blood cell in the body constantly. And also its relationship to the cosmos is changing constantly. It has to do with every cell in our body is like a little mini factory. It's constantly changing, being modified. Even the DNA, its position in relationship to the cosmos, is ceaselessly changing. So there's infinite changes taking place in the body constantly, right? And everything is in a different relationship slightly to everything else each moment. The neurons that are firing in the brain never fire in exactly the same way. And every firing of the neuron, the next moment, that firing is in a different relationship with the entire cosmos. So we're getting into very heavy territory here, but it's not too heavy. You know, I feel fine with it. I'm just trying to fend off the mosquitoes here, which is the one drawback of the weather warming up, as you get chewed up by mosquitoes. Actually, I have some things that put out a sound the mosquitoes don't like. I need to activate those. That would help. But there again, mosquitoes are moving about, bugs are moving about. We're in a vast, ceaseless whirlpool, aren't we? And there's a little bird suddenly showed up very close. And that bird is very active, building a nest or doing something. As it flies about, its positioning is changing constantly. Its little heart is beating, and it's always, everything in the body is being modified constantly. We're sloughing off cells constantly, building new cells constantly. Get a sense of this ceaseless change, ceaseless modification. Really, that is the core insight. One of the core insights, we can say for sure. This has been talked about ceaselessly, is that throughout history, of the seeing that everything is impermanent, the impermanence of the world, the impermanence of the cosmos, the impermanence of the delusion of stability here, the idea that we're in the same place, we're not in the same place. We wake up in our bed, and the planet has actually traveled, you know, thousands and thousands and thousands of miles. We go to sleep, we wake up, we're in a spatially, our spatial relationship with everything else has changed greatly, drastically. I don't know, maybe tens of thousands of miles or something. It's different. And yet we think, we wake up, we're in the same bed, we believe we haven't gone anywhere. Nothing's changed. Totally not true. I pity those who have to try and figure out the cosmos. They've certainly tried, but everything is in a changing relationship with everything else. And so they always are saying, well, we had it figured out, but something we didn't quite take into account took place and things have changed. Yeah. And why even bother? Don't need to. Just see the scope of the situation. Seeing the scope of the situation automatically brings us to the remedy. Once we see just how all-encompassing the situation is, then we will say, wow, the remedy has to be all-encompassing as well. That our body, we can't stop our body. Our bodies are literally moving at, I guess, thousands of miles an hour through space right now as we're talking. We are literally moving through space, not only the Earth spinning on its axis, but also orbiting around the sun and the whole movement of the solar system around the galaxy, as well as the galaxy also moving. All of that is taking place. I don't know how fast we are literally moving through space, but it's probably thousands of miles an hour or more right now as we're sitting here. And so we think we're sitting still. We're not. You might say that this world provides an illusion of stability. We think that tree right there is not moving. A tree is moving very rapidly through space. We think that only those people in the airplane are moving quickly. Oh no. As far as moving through space, they're pretty much moving at the same speed we are, really. Because even moving from point A to B on the planet doesn't have anything to do with the planet's spin, much to do with the spin and the orbiting and the orbiting of the solar system, etc. It's negligible. And even if we try to negate that by moving in some counter direction, everything else in the cosmos is moving very quickly too. Different rates of speed for sure. The light that we're seeing is moving very rapidly. And as it moves, it changes its orientation to everything as it's speeding along. So we're left with this existential crisis here of we have, you know, where's our identity? Where's our stability? Where's our center? You know, we might realize, well, there isn't one really in the cosmos, which is why we say, not that, not that, not that. And we say, well, that is the overlay. The stability comes from choosing the overlay. And the crickets are starting up now. See, there's another change. I bet you those crickets don't realize they're flying through space on a spaceship. And that everything else in space is also flying through space. Those crickets are experiencing total transformation every moment. Literally, we are experiencing total transformation every moment as far as our spatial relationships go. There's no way to stop it. But we don't need to stop it, because all that this is a dream scenario, an imagined scenario of forgetfulness of what we are. So we don't need to stop that. We need to simply choose the idea of not trying to change what we are. Not trying to be prime creator. That would be a change in what we are. And the effect of that is stable. And so that's how we resolve the situation, not by trying to enforce some kind of stability on the cosmos where we know it's impossible. Because there's zero stability here. Everything is whirling about with all this momentum, vast dynamics of momentum everywhere. Instead of fighting against that, just say, no, that it is what it is. That's the effect of that arises from trying to be prime creator. We know that. Now we'll choose a different idea, the idea of not trying to be prime creator. And the effect that arises from that is just one effect, one stable effect. And we can experience that, and then that will remind us of what we are. Always keep in mind that this cosmos did not rise out of any necessity. Rather, it arose out of a whim on the part of spirit to be prime creator. That's how it arose. That's why it arose. That's the origin. That's what is causing it to arise and continue on. That's it. Nothing more than that. It's just an attempt to forget what we are, which is futile, because what we are cannot be modified or changed or forgotten. Well, we're rolling along here, getting closer to 1 hour. I think it's a good time to stop the satsang and see if it processes. And if it does process and we're successful with this, then we can try a longer one and we can expand it in scope. Which would be a great thing. So let us thank you for attending the satsang, and we really were able to get into an extremely profound place unexpectedly. I usually don't have any topic that I'm thinking about when I start. I just have faith that we will, since the will is there, that some deep insight will get into a very profound area, guaranteed. And it always turns out that way, because the intention is there. We simply let the intention expand, let it have its voice, let it speak, so to speak. And let that intention guide us into profound areas that are very helpful for us. Okay, let us then stop this video, and I will say, that's it.